My name is Abe Gardner, and I'm the EMG product manager for Cadwell. I want to thank you for joining us today for our Education in Isolation webinar series. The topic today is Uncommon Upper Limb Nerve Conduction Studies, Utility and Demonstration. It will be presented by Dr. Devin Rubin and Jennifer Walker. Devin is a professor of neurology and director of the EMG laboratory at Mayo Clinic in Jacksonville, Florida. Dr. Rubin is also a member of the AANEM and ACNS, and he's been involved in EMG education around the world. Jennifer Walcord has her master's degree in science from the University of Florida, and she has had her RNCST certification through AAT since 2008, and she's worked at the Mayo Clinic Neuro Lab as a neurophysiology tech for the past 12 years. Both Dr. Rubin and Jennifer have opted to forego compensation for this. In lieu of Cadwell donating to the COVID-19 Response Fund for the World Health Organization. We encourage anyone participating to also donate to this important cause if you're able. Donations can be made at the website, COVID-19ResponseFund.com. There's also a link on our website. Please feel free to ask questions as we go. We have a pretty big audience, so try to keep them relevant, and I will try to field those questions as they come in. The audio is turned off for attendees, so to ask questions, just enter them in the question field in the right-hand side of your screen. There will also be time for a few questions after the presentation as well. Dr. Rubin, if you can turn on your video, I'll explain a little bit about how you can interact with the software while you're watching. So you, on the screen, you can see there, Dr. Rubin and Jennifer on the top and probably their screen below. You can actually adjust the size of the video versus their screen share by dragging that bar up and down, or in the bottom right hand corner of the screen, there's two arrows that will expand and take it to full screen. If you maximize the window that they're in, it'll give you a better experience and you'll be able to see the, both the video and the software in a better format. But I'll go ahead and turn the time over to Dr. Rubin and Jennifer, and thanks again for helping us out today.
Well, thank you, Abe. Welcome to everyone who's watching live. Good afternoon, good evening, good morning, wherever you are. Hopefully you're having a good day and everyone is safe. As Abe said, I'm Devin Rubin. I look like this without a mask. And this is Jennifer.
Hello.
We're coming to you from our EMG laboratory at Mayo Clinic in Jacksonville, Florida. And at Mayo Clinic nowadays, it's a requirement to wear masks, so hopefully you'll be able to hear us okay, but we will be wearing our masks during this seminar, this webinar. So the goal of this webinar, what we thought we would do is we would discuss and demonstrate uncommon nerve conduction studies. We're going to make this more of a demonstration. We don't want this to be a lecture. And certainly, as Abe said, if you have questions as we're demonstrating the conduction studies, please send them or ask them on the chat. We're happy to try to answer as we go through a number of the conduction studies. This is a first for us. Neither of us have done webinars. We're not AV tech, so hopefully everything will look okay and you'll be able to see everything appropriately. And we'll try to do our best so you can learn how to do these techniques or at least update your skills for those of you who already do these. I just wanted to start with just a couple brief slides about uncommon nerve conduction studies and before we start the demonstration. This is the learning objectives. And as I said, really the main discussion here in the demonstration, we're going to be talking about when we do the studies, what are the indications, and then mainly focus on the technique and some of the pitfalls that occur in some of these studies. We'll demonstrate both motor and sensory conduction studies in the arm. We're not going to do any leg studies today. So when we talk about uncommon nerve conduction studies, the question is, well, what makes something uncommon? Why would we consider a nerve conduction study uncommon? And what may be common for us may be uncommon for you, or what may be common for you may be uncommon for us. And it really depends in many ways on the how often you're doing the study. So there are a number of nerves we don't do very often. They're either not indicated for the clinical problem. That's probably the main reason that something's uncommon, that we just don't need to do a phrenic nerve on a patient that has arm pain or some of these less common conductions. But it's important to know how to do them, because when the situation arises, you need to be comfortable in performing these studies. Another reason it might be uncommon is you haven't learned how to perform it. And so there's a tendency, if you don't know how to perform it, to sort of shy away from actually doing it when it's necessary. And then sometimes we shy away from some of these because they are technically difficult in certain patients. So it's challenging. Once you say it's hard at times and sometimes frustrating to know if you're getting an accurate response. So that makes it not uncommon, but it's harder to do these uncommon studies. So this slide just lists a variety of nerves. And I would say in green are the ones that we routinely perform multiple times a day. And in the arm, our motor studies are typically the median and ulnar. And the sensory studies are usually a median. I don't think I have it here, do I? Yeah, I do. The sensory studies, the median and ulnar, and radial, which we're going to demonstrate, that's fairly common in our laboratory, but may not be common in some of yours. There's a long list of nerves on the right that are uncommon. And again, it's not that we don't perform these, but we aren't performing these routinely on a daily basis. There are a couple practical points, and we'll demonstrate this, that when you're performing uncommon motor conduction studies, it's really important to pay attention to the waveforms. That's important for any nerve conduction study, that when you're stimulating a motor nerve and you're recording over a muscle, no matter where you're stimulating along the nerve, the wave in a normal nerve, the waveform should look identical or nearly identical. And you can see that here in this ulnar motor study stimulating at the wrist, the below elbow and above elbow. If we stimulated all the way up to Herb's point, those waveforms would look the same. And that's because the motor axons are a similar diameter and they're conducting at the same rate. So the waveform, there isn't going to be much dispersion or phase cancellation. That's a little different for sensory studies. If you have an uncommon study or technically challenging motor conduction study and the waveforms look different, like in the bottom screen there, you might tend to say, well, that's a conduction block. But you always have to be careful that it's not technical. And if someone has a large drop in amplitude or a waveform that changes in shape, if it's true block, the patient should be weak. So you have to keep that in mind, that if the patient's completely strong and the waveform looks like that bottom right waveform, that's probably a technical problem rather than a true block. And then the challenge on sensory studies, uncommon sensory studies, is that you don't often know where the nerve runs. It's a small nerve. And so it's hard to know where to stimulate. It's hard to know where to place the recording electrodes. And it often requires sliding the stimulator. And Jennifer will show you how to do that when we do some of these conduction studies. Another thing we sometimes do is ask the patient, if you think you're stimulating the nerve, ask them, do they feel the electrical shock going down in the dermatome of where that nerve supplies. So those are some simple techniques that can help you be more confident that you're actually stimulating the nerve. Anything else so far?
Sounds good. Yeah.
So what we're gonna do is I'm gonna be the patient, and Jennifer gets the opportunity to shock me. And so I'm gonna move over and we're gonna start with some conduction studies down distally. We'll start with some sensory conduction studies in the arm, and then we'll move over to the motors. As I said, we are not AV technicians, so hopefully you'll be able to see everything okay. I can move, so that's not good.
Yeah, I'm gonna have to start.
Okay. So we're going to start off with a nerve that's actually fairly common, just to give you a sense of how we perform a sensory nerve conduction study. We're going to do the radial sensory.
All right, so first we're just going to clean the skin. And then we're going to put the ground on. This will be on the dorsum of the hand. So we're doing the radial sensory first. We're going to feel for the radial sensory, the superficial radial nerve, as it goes over the extensor pollicis longus tendon. So we'll have the patient do the thumbs up gesture, and you're going to feel on the top of this tendon, and I can feel the nerve right there. So G1 is going to go over that nerve.
I'm going to move this a little bit closer to the camera so you can kind of see that. Can you usually palpate that nerve? Can you feel it?
Yes.
What does it feel like?
Feels like a little string that's going over, I don't know.
Yeah, it feels wire. Like a little bump. If you're all sitting at home with nothing to do while you're watching this, extend your thumb and rub your finger over that tendon, and you may feel a little bump there, kind of rolling under, and that's a little branch of the radial nerve.
Okay, so then G2, our reference electrode, is going to be 3.5 to 4 centimeters away. It'll be over the second metacarpal adjacent to the FDI. Let's move this down so you can see a little bit better here. Okay. We're going to put the thermometer probe distally on the hand. Just going to tape it down. And then I like to tie my wires a couple times. It helps just keep the wires neat and it reduces artifact. And always make sure that my wires are not hanging down off the bed. They're just kind of jumbled up. This also helps to reduce artifact. I make a little dot in the middle of my G1 electrode. And then we're going to be measuring 10 centimeters proximally along the dorsal edge of the forearm from G1. We're going to make a little mark at 10 centimeters, and that's where we're going to stimulate. We like to use the small head for a nerve like this that's superficial, so it doesn't innervate other nerves in the area. And so I also like to make sure that I'm touching the patient so that I can kind of keep myself in one spot. If I'm just holding it like this, it's easy to move off the nerve. And you want to make sure that you can very carefully control where the stimulator is. So, and I got a little bit of conduction paste, just a little bit. All right, so up at the top, if you look up, I'm turning on my volume, and then we're going to start the stimulation. We go up slowly. Now I'm going to slide. You see 19, 27, 32. Okay, I'm going to go back to 32, and now I'm going to raise up the stimulation again. Now it's not getting any higher, so I'm going to go ahead and average. We usually like about 3 to 4 waves to average.
I'm gonna just mention something. This isn't specific to any, it's pertinent to every conduction study, and I'd like you to maybe do this again, is decrease the stimulus intensity back to about 15. And as Jennifer said, when we increase the stimulus intensity, we increase in small increments. So you'll notice she didn't go from 0 to 30. She went up just by about 5 or 10, about 5 milliamps with each increase. And that's important to make sure you're not overstimulating. And in fact, if you look there, if you are you still averaging?
No.
Or no. So she's not averaging. If she gives another shock, the amplitude's exactly the same as it was when she was up at 30. So really 15 milliamps is about all you need in me to get a response. There's no reason to be given much higher stimulus. And so you have to be careful about overstimulating for any nerve conduction study. The other thing she did, and I'll ask you to do again, is she slid. So you don't know how much stimulus you need for each nerve. So you want to be as you want the stimulator to be as close as possible to the nerve itself to reduce the amount of current. And to do that, you increase the stimulus to just getting a threshold response. In fact, maybe drop it down to about 10. And then watch her hand when as it's stimulating at 10. Watch what she's doing with her hand. You can see this. She's going to slide just about a millimeter or two. And then you see it's the amplitude's dropping, so she's further away. But she's not moving much, just a little bit until she finds where that nerve is. And there it is. She's at the right spot right there. And now she knows she's right over the nerve. And then she's going to increase a little bit to make sure that she's maximal.
And then we would average at this point.
So that's the radial sensory. Some places will stimulate up at the elbow to obtain a conduction velocity. Have you ever done that?
Yes.
Yeah, but not we don't usually.
We don't do it that often.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So most of the time we're really just interested in the amplitude of the response. We're not too worried about the velocity. So we don't routinely stimulate up here at the elbow, but you could, and we'll show that when we do the radial motor where you would stimulate. And that can give you a conduction velocity between the two sites of stimulation. So, and then I guess the other point with this, and again, this is a fairly common conduction in our lab, but to think about why would you perform this? In what situations is the radial sensory conduction performed? And what do you think? When are you doing these?
We would do it, well, one, if they think that there's you know, a problem with the radial nerve, we would do the motor and the sensory of that nerve. Or if we wanted to look for an upper trunk plexus, we would add that.
Yeah, so.
And also like if it's a peripheral neuropathy and we have abnormalities in the median sensory and ulnar sensory, we'll add the radial sensory as well to make sure we're seeing it in all three.
Yeah. Yeah, so those are, I know you can't see us, but hopefully you're hearing us okay. Those are the common reasons. I would say probably of those three, the most common is in a situation where a patient has peripheral neuropathy. They have numbness in their feet, a little bit in their hand. You do conductions in the leg and it looks like neuropathy. And then we typically will check a motor and a sensory in an arm. So ours for our sensory, we typically do a median sensory. And in many situations, the median sensory distal latency is prolonged. So then what's going through your mind?
Well, we're not sure if it's due to a neuropathy or if it's due to a carpal tunnel.
Right. So then we compare the median sensory to the ulnar sensory, and then sometimes that's low.
Yes. And if the ulnar sensory is also abnormal, now we're thinking, well, it may be a generalized process.
Or it may be carpal tunnel and ulnar neuropathy. And people that have peripheral neuropathy often are predisposed to having compression neuropathy. So now you're stuck saying, well, is this all due to the neuropathy in the hand or is it mononeuropathies too? And that's where the radial sensory is very helpful. If the radial sensory is low, it's probably a more diffuse neuropathy. If the radial sensory looks like mine and it's great, then it's probably a superimposed carpal tunnel and ulnar neuropathy. Okay, so we go on to another nerve.
Yep. And normally, and so then would just
and if
measure.
There, and if there are questions, as Abe said, about the specific nerve that we're on, feel free to ask as we're doing the nerve.
Okay, so we're going to move on to the dorsal ulnar cutaneous. All right, so I'm just going to move my temperature probe over.
So the dorsal ulnar cutaneous nerve is a branch of the ulnar nerve. So why do we do this? Why not just do the ulnar sensory to the pinky, which is our standard ulnar sensory?
If we're suspecting ulnar nerve compression at the wrist, we would do the dorsal ulnar cutaneous because the dorsal ulnar cutaneous branches off higher. And if there's a compression, it's going to be affecting the sensory fibers that we can pick up with the rings.
Right.
So if there's an abnormality there and we can't tell if the compression is at the wrist or somewhere else, doing this test helps a lot because the dorsal ulnar cutaneous will be preserved if the lesion is at the wrist.
Yeah, exactly. So in ulnar neuropathies, just to reiterate this, because this is an important nerve. It's not commonly done, but it's important. Ulnar neuropathies are common. Most of the time they're at the elbow. And what happens, the typical EM nerve conduction finding is if it's severe, then you have an absent response, right? Really severe, no ulnar sensory, no ulnar motor. If it's classic and it's not as severe, you may have a low ulnar sensory to the fifth digit, and you might find conduction block or conduction slowing across the elbow. But a lot of times with axonal ulnar neuropathies, there's not much slowing across the elbow. You just have a low amplitude in the sensory and the motor, and you can't localize it. Even with inching, you can't localize it at the elbow. So now, if the amplitudes are low, but you can't localize it across the elbow, you don't know, is it at the elbow with axonal degeneration, or is there an unusual ulnar neuropathy at Guillain's canal or at the wrist? And as Jennifer said, the dorsal ulnar cutaneous nerve comes off of the main branch of the ulnar nerve proximal to the wrist. So if you have compression right here at the wrist, the duct has come off proximal to that, and it's going to be spared in a lesion at the wrist. In contrast, if you have an ulnar neuropathy at the elbow with axonal degeneration, the duct is going to be abnormal. So that's where it's really helpful if you can't localize it with your standard techniques.
So the way we're going to set up is you're going to feel between the fourth and fifth metacarpal. And this is where G1 is going to go. G2 is going to be 3.5 to 4 centimeters distal to G1 over the base of the fifth digit. And then we're going to measure from G1. We're going to go up to the flexor carpi ulnaris tendon. So you kind of have to wrap your tape around a little bit. And we're going to go 8 centimeters. We're going to be stimulating right here. And the ground's going to be between G1 and where you're stimulating.
I missed two questions on the previous nerve that I just noticed. Just quick, are you sliding both cathode and anode around as you're adjusting to find the stim point?
Are you moving both the cathode and anode?
Yes, I am.
Great. And is it possible to get an orthodromic response at that site? That was a question from...
I'm going to make one comment about the first question. Yeah, when you're sliding, as Jennifer said, you move both the cathode and anode. So you're moving sort of perpendicular to the nerve. That's different than rotating if you're trying to reduce shock artifact. So if you're rotating, maybe you can just demonstrate how you rotate. If you have shock artifact and you're trying to redirect the current direction, then what do you do?
So basically, if you're on the nerve, but you just have a lot of artifact, you're going to be moving your anode. So your cathode is going to be in the same spot and you're just going to rotate the anode around and try to flatten out that initial the initial baseline.
And we might see that on one of the other nerves.
Yeah, we'll do it on another one.
Yeah.
But then if we're trying to locate the nerve, we're moving both of them. We're picking it up and moving the whole stimulator, both anode and cathode at the same time to find the nerve.
Yeah. And then the question about doing, what was it? Can you do an orthodromic radial conduction, sensory conduction studies? I suppose you could. We've never done that. But you could stimulate here and you could record if this is what they're asking, if you could record proximally. The problem I would see with doing that on the radial is the radial nerve proximally is very deep. And we'll see on the radial motor study that it's very hard to stimulate the radial nerve. You have to push the stimulator deep. And so if you're using a surface electrode to record a sensor response, it's going to be really difficult. In fact, I'm not sure we'd be able to do that. Theoretically, you could. I don't think it's practical to do that.
Okay, so I'm going to bring up the dorsal ulnar on our screen here.
What do you see on the screen?
So it looks like there's a little noise down here in this window. At this point, we ask the patient to either try to relax, because this is indicating there's muscle, that there's some tension. And if they can't relax enough, we might just reposition
and I'm not tense even though I'm being shocked. So this is an important, this is, I think, maybe you can comment. I think this is one of the technical problems with this nerve, because the electrodes over the inner ossei muscles, and it's hard. I'm trying to relax, and it's very hard to fully relax that muscle, and that can interfere with your sensory response.
Mm-hmm. Question on why you put the thermometer on the dorsum of the hand instead of along the course of the superficial radial nerve.
We have a standard position for when we measure the temperature in the upper and lower limb. We have a standard position, and that's how our normal values were obtained. So our temperature probe is always on the dorsum of the hand and the dorsum of the foot. I don't know that it matters if we put it right over the nerve. We're not measuring directly the temperature of the nerve. It's more likely that if the limb's cool here, it's going to be warmer higher up. So you're more likely to identify a cooler limb with a more distal temperature. You could put it right there also, but.
Okay, so I'm making sure that the cathode is facing G1.
Trying to relax.
All right, so I'm just going to hold my position by using my thumb here while Dr. Rubin tries to relax.
I'm deep breathing, trying to relax.
Okay, so we're going to start.
So you can see what it, so pause it right there. So don't be fooled. Don't say, oh, that's a huge response. That's all muscle artifact. You want a sharp rise time. That looks like a sharp rise time, but that's not the sensory response. That's not the sensory either.
We had a comment that with a large enough ground electrode, one can simply put the temperature probe underneath the ground. Would you recommend that?
I wouldn't recommend it, although I think that's done here by some people. I personally think it's better to have all the electrodes, whether it's a temperature probe, a ground electrode, everything
separate from each other. The electrode, if for some reason, I don't think the temperature probe would actually emit an artifactual signal, but if it's under the ground, you might pick up some artifact.
I'm gonna go a little more medially.
So this is a tricky nerve, and you know, my nerves are pretty good, but this is hard. It's, and part of the reason that it's difficult, there it is not only the motor artifact, but it doesn't come off at exactly the same spot from the ulnar nerve. So this is one, and it may be hard to see a little bit, but Jennifer's sliding around. There's a response, and that's consistent. There's still a little bit of motor artifact. I'm going to just bend my fingers a little. It's also not often a very high amplitude response.
It's just right under this.
So you can see if you start to bring in, remember this nerve, this is under, is lying over ulnar innervated muscles. So if you slide the stimulator and you slide or give too much stimulus and you stimulate the ulnar nerve proper, this muscle here, the interosseous, is going to depolarize and you're going to get that big CMAP, that big motor artifact that's going to interfere. So let's try it again. And remember, if you've slid around, you always want to wipe off the paste. So that's bringing in motor, a large motor. So what Jennifer's doing is sliding away from that main nerve. And I'm not being a good patient because I'm moving. That's coming up a little more proximally. Now, there are unusual occasions that you may not get a really good ulnar, dorsal ulnar cutaneous response, and it's not indicative of a disease. Has that ever happened?
Yes, it is. It has happened.
There is something that people aren't as familiar with. I'm not sure that I have this, but it's an anomalous innervation of the dorsal ulnar cutaneous portion of the skin. So this is the area that the dorsal ulnar cutaneous usually supplies. In about 15% of the normal population, this area of the hand is supplied by the superficial radial nerve. So the radial branch comes over and innervates this. And so if you have a situation, I don't know that that's the case with me, although I do have an accessory peroneal nerve, so I might have some other unusual anatomy. But if you're not getting a good response, then one thing to do is, and we'll test this out in a few minutes, is to move the stimulator over to the superficial radial nerve and see if you pick up a response here. And again, in about 15% of the population, they have that anomalous variant.
One comment and one question. The comment was Nancy Mansell said, when she supports at the palmar wrist crease, it allows the patient to relax a little bit better.
Supporting it, yeah.
And then the question is the dorsal ulnar cutaneous nerve better at localizing an ulnar compression than recording from the first dorsal interosseous?
the second question, the first point is a good point. Thank you for that point. The second question, it's not better at precisely localizing. I don't know if you can compare. I don't know if anyone's compared, but with the FDI, the recording from the first dorsal interosseous, sometimes the fascicles to that muscle are affected more than the fascicles to the ADM. So if the question's regarding ulnar neuropathy at the elbow, it may not be a bad idea. And we sometimes do two channel recording from FDI and ADM. And you might pick up slowing more to the FDI or even a focal conduction block than you will to the ADM. I don't think that happens very often, but the FDI may be helpful on a motor study to localize to the elbow. If you're talking about localizing a distal ulnar neuropathy at the wrist, all the dorsal ulnar cutaneous does is if it's normal, it tells you it's somewhere distal. The FDI isn't going to really help you at that point because that could be affected as well. So I'm going to try.
So I just moved you one down a little to see if I could kind of get away from some of that muscle.
And now it's always good if a patient can help prop up your.
Okay.
So again, it's very easy to, that sensor response is going to come right before the motor response. It looks like it might be trying to pop in there a little bit.
Do you want to lay something underneath here?
No, I think I'm pretty, I think I'm. That motor effect's good.
Yeah, it's good. Yeah, I got good muscle there.
So you can see again, she's sliding just a little bit, and now she's depolarizing the main ulnar nerve, and that's the ulnar motor response. And sometimes it's just a matter of tweaking that stimulus intensity, going down a little bit, just moving the electrode just a little bit, the stimulator just a little bit.
One question is this the typical pulse width you use for a sensory? It seems short to that person.
0.1. No, that's what we use. So why don't we show how to stimulate the radial? Let's make sure I haven't grown an anomalous anatomy here.
Do we have that up here?
No, you can just do it on the same screen. We're going to just show you, if you're not sure, stimulate the same site you would stimulate the radial sensory without moving the recording electrodes.
You put the camera down just a bit. They can't see the
sensor. Oh, yeah.
So just on the dorsal edge of the forearm here.
Yeah, it shouldn't take very much stimulus. It only took about 15 to. So as a patient, I can feel the shock going down into the radial area. I don't feel it in the dorsal area, dorsal cutaneous area. So I don't have anomalous anatomy. So, you know, we're not gonna, you can see even here, even in me, this is sometimes challenging. I'm gonna just see if I can find my own nerve. So let's. That's the ulnar motor. as a patient, most patients can't often tell you where they're feeling this. Sometimes they can. I can tell exactly where my nerve's running, so I know where I'm stimulating. I can feel it. So I'm sliding around. It's a little bit hard to see. I'm doing exactly what Jennifer did, and I'm sliding. And I'm not feeling it.
I think it's the muscle. It's just hiding it.
Yeah, it's hard to do that on your own.
Yeah.
Let's try one more time, then we're going to move on to another nerve. That you're at.
Try to get
really relaxed. Hold on.
Okay. There's a few comments, but there's a question: is it possible to deselect aberrant tracings from the averaging of the sensory? And I don't think you're averaging right now. But you could once you have acquired an average, correct?
I missed the question. So we're not averaging now.
Yeah, they're asking if it's possible to deselect aberrant tracings from the averaging of the sensory.
Yeah, you could. Right, you can select the traces to average after you've collected a few also.
All
right. Here it is. I feel it going right into that area. So that's it.
Okay, so everyone can see that. Okay.
So now, just to demonstrate. Yeah. So
we'll show you. We just hit average, turns all the little circles into squares, and then you can go back and select what you want to choose to average.
So that's it. And it's small in me. It's 8. We don't use normal values for this in our lab. We compare side to side. So if there was a question about, so if I had symptoms and we're trying to localize the ulnar nerve to the wrist or the elbow, we would compare this to the other side. A fun nerve, right?
That wasn't very fun.
So again, the take home points here is it's an important nerve to be able to do. It does require work. It is hard. It's hard to get relaxation. It's a small response. And then an important take-home point that people aren't as familiar with is what we demonstrated, to look for anomalous anatomy if you're not getting a good response. I don't have it, but it's easy to quickly check. It's kind of like a ulnar sensory Martin Gruber anastomosis in a way. So we're going to move on to the antebrachial cutaneous conductions.
Okay, so I guess we'll start with the
lateral.
Yeah. Does it show everything?
Click the forearm. Yeah.
All right.
So what situations do you do this one?
For the lateral antebrachial cutaneous, that would be kind of like an upper trunk, if we're going to evaluate upper trunk plexus. It's the lateral cord.
Yeah.
This is also comes off the muscular cutaneous. So.
Yep. So how often would you say you do these here? The lateral and medial.
It's not rare.
Yeah.
You know.
We see a lot of patients with plexopathies here, sent for plexopathy evaluation. Anytime someone sent for a brachial plexopathy, if the suspicion is an upper trunk or lateral cord, I would say we probably always do the lateral antebrachial and the radial. If you're thinking upper trunk, those are good sensory conductions that the fibers course through the upper trunk. If we're sorting out a ulnar neuropathy from a C8 root problem from a lower trunk medial cord plexopathy, then we do the medial antebrachial. We don't see a lot of musculocutaneous neuropathies, but that would be the other indication for the lateral antebrachial.
A question from our friend Martin Kultzenberg in the UK, actually at Queen Square. He said, in side comparison, what is your percentage cutoff for abnormality, 50% snap amplitude difference? And he said, by the way, glad that you also sometimes find it difficult to find the duck.
Well, I'm glad that you're not, that we're not the only one, too. So that's a really good question. The short answer is we use a 50% side-to-side difference. And I think that's often what's published in the literature and what people consider. The real life answer is, in the right clinical scenario, I would not use that as an absolute cutoff. And if someone came in and they had a suspicion of, let's say, of what we're going to show, a lateral antebrachial or upper trunk plexopathy, and on the affected limb, their amplitude was 5, and on the unaffected limb, their let's say their amplitude on the affected limb was 10, and on the unaffected limb, it was 18. That's not an exact 50% side-to-side difference, but in the right clinical context, it would raise my suspicion that it's still abnormal. But if you're looking for kind of a general rule, then we use a 50% side-to-side amplitude difference.
And one other question, how do you warm the extremity if it's cold in your practice?
How do we warm the extremity? You want to answer that?
Yes, so we actually have something that looks like a refrigerator that warms up blankets. And we also have a little basin, a thermolator, that has hot water that we float some of our hot packs in. So what I would do is I would wrap up the arm with the blanket from here to here, and then I put the heat pack on the hand. And then we wait about 10 minutes so that most of the limb is warmed.
Yeah, that's what we use. We have a heating tub, which we hardly ever use. If patients were really cold, we would soak their limbs in hot water for 10 minutes. But we use the blanket and the mm-hmm. hot pad work well.
Yeah. So we're going to start with the lateral antebrachial cutaneous. So I'm just feeling we got the biceps tendon here at the elbow. We're going to be stimulating just lateral to the biceps tendon, just above the elbow crease. I'm just making a little mark there so that I know where I'm stimulating. And then we're going to draw a line from that spot to the radial styloid. We're going to make a mark at 12 and 16. That'll be G1 and G2 respectively. And this is a superficial nerve, so we're going to keep the pins close together. We call this our small head.
I think one of the technical pitfalls of this, well, what would you say are the technical problems with this?
Usually it's difficult if someone's very muscular, because you're going to be bringing in a lot of muscle, and this nerve is very small. So trying to tease out the nerve from the muscle can be challenging.
Yeah, and you can see it on the free running sweep. I like to think I'm really muscular. I'm not, but my muscles are strong. So I'm trying to relax, and it's hard to fully relax that forearm.
So actually, when I have this problem, I usually just kind of rotate the arm in a little bit. Sometimes that helps. Okay. So it looks quieter. So we're going to go ahead and start here. I'm going to slide. I went down, so I'm going back the other way. And this looks better. So I'm going to go back to around the 30s, and then I'm going to bring it up a little bit more. Make sure I'm super max, and then I'm going to average since it didn't get any bigger. Okay, and then I just make sure I mark where I ended up for my measurement.
And I would just make a point, and you can maybe comment. We do encourage sliding for all nerves, but as you may have noticed, that came in at 9 milliamps, and it was really a nice amplitude. And I think in some of the nerves, particularly if they're challenging and you get a nice response at a low stimulus intensity, I don't know that you necessarily have to slide much because you're probably right on the nerve if it's that low. If you're going up and you're at 15, 20, 25 milliamps and you're not finding anything, then absolutely you should slide. So I think, I don't know if you always slide or if you would have gotten that, if you would have said, you know, you were doing the show. Yeah. So Jennifer saying if, you know, if you got it at 9 milliamps, you would just increase your stimulus and take.
Right. I'm efficient in the room, but I was trying to just show you how it changes and just.
Yeah. But I think it's an important point. We encourage, it's important to slide. So you don't overstimulate, but if you get a good response at a low intensity, you probably don't need to. Mm-hmm.
Okay. And we're just gonna measure between our stim site and G1.
This is another nerve we don't worry too much about velocity. It's gonna calculate the velocity, but we're really looking at amplitude. If you have processes that affect this nerve, if you have a musculocutaneous neuropathy or plexopathy, it's very unlikely that it's going to only produce conduction velocity slowing of this nerve.
So we're going to move on to the medial and a brachial. So you're going to be medial to the biceps tendon this time. You want to feel for the brachial artery. So I'll be about here. So we're going to measure, or we're going to make a line from the ulnar styloid to our stim site. And along this line, we're going to mark it 12 and 16. So that's G1 and G2, respectively. Okay, so I just got a little more paste. And I'll make sure my wires are up and. All right, so we're gonna start here.
This is
Can you feel the nerve?
Maybe a tip. There it is.
Okay. So I do like to ask the patient if they can feel the shock traveling down in the forearm. Sometimes it helps me locate it, and I'm going to bring it up a little. Okay. So in this case, since there's muscle coming in and it's starting to get to interfere with my response, I'll go ahead and go back and grab those last few. Take off the ones that are obscured with the muscle.
And one of the problems is if you go too high on the stimulus, maybe you can keep stimulating on average for a second.
Okay.
And back down on your stimulus a little and now stimulate. So if you go too high, you'll see what happens. So that's a pretty good response. Go up just a little bit. So part of that's me not relaxing, but if you go too high, you might directly stimulate the muscle. Go up a little more. A little more. So you're not really seeing it here. Towards the end of the screen, you're seeing a little bit of more motor artifact, but if you go too high, you can stimulate the muscle and that can interfere. Mm-hmm. This is a smaller response than the lateral antebrachial. It's a smaller nerve. So you don't want to compare the amplitude between lateral and medial. They're going to be very different in amplitude.
So this is a little more challenging doing the medial antebrachial than the lateral antebrachial. So we do have another method that we've started using that can help bring in a better response. So what we do is, from where we think we're going to be stimulating, we're still going to have a span of 12 centimeters, but we're going to put our 6 where we're going to stimulate, and we're going to mark 6 centimeters proximally, and then 6 centimeters distally. And then you also be marking the 16 centimeters spot. So basically, we're going to be just stimulating 6 centimeters proximal to our original stimulation site. And then it still will be at 12 and 16 from where we're stimulating, as where we put G1 and G2.
So we're basically shifting that 12 centimeters proximal. This was a technique that was described back in the 80s, stimulating the nerve more proximally. Back then, I believe that the papers still recorded over the forearm, but we've been recording a little more proximally. And it does seem to get away from some of that muscle artifact and sometimes gives a little higher amplitude response.
Okay, so we're going to go ahead and just demonstrate that.
Maybe go on trial 2.
All right.
Doesn't totally get away from the muscle. So you can see it's just a little bit of sliding, and you still can bring in muscle, or you can. In this situation, it's not any better than that original technique. Right. The amplitude looks about the same, a little bit more motor artifact. Mm-hmm. So any questions on that, Abe, coming through? What are we doing on time?
Just one, what are you using to prep the skin and as conductive gel?
So we're just using alcohol to prep the skin. And this is the conductive gel called Synapse Conductive Electrode Cream.
So I think we'll do one.
We also have this.
Yeah.
This is something else that we use. It's kind of like a sandpaper tape. It's sticky on one side. And what we would do is just tear a little bit off. And then we would abrade the skin a little bit if we are having a real hard time with artifact.
Mainly for the sensory studies, right?
Yes.
Yeah. Those are the main sensory studies that we do in the arm besides the common ones. I know our hour is getting up, but maybe we'll demonstrate one motor during this webinar. We might have to do another one sometime. And I think maybe the radial motor. Radial motor can be a challenging conduction, and it's an important one to be able to do, not only for a question of radial neuropathy, mononeuropathy, but sometimes we see some unusual disorders like multifocal motor neuropathy with conduction block that often will have a predilection to the radial nerve. We don't often do this for CIDP, but if you're kind of looking for a conduction block or demyelination and people have finger and wrist extensor weakness, then it's an important nerve to test.
Yep. So we're going to be recording over the extensor digitorum communis. So we're going to be measuring about 10 centimeters from the lateral epicondyle. So we're going to be about here. We're going to have the patient tap his middle finger. So I can feel the muscle here. Okay.
What do you do if they have finger drop and they can't move their finger?
I guess.
You guess, yeah. That's the tough thing is, if they can move their finger up and down, you can feel the muscle and know where to place the electrode. If they can't move because they have wrist drop or finger drop, you have to use kind of your landmarks and sort of estimate where that bulk of that muscle is. Mm-hmm.
So So G1 is going to go right there, and G2 is just on the dorsum of the wrist. We're going to put the ground just on the back of the elbow here. And then we're going to be stimulating. It's very, very deep. It's going to be lateral to the biceps tendon, but under the brachioradialis muscle. So you want to spread out the pins. And then, so what I do is I'm going to feel for where I'm going to go, right at the elbow. You're going to press in, and then you're actually going to like point the pins upward. No, I'm pressing already.
That's okay.
Okay. All right, so I'm going to do that again. Press in and then rotate up. And I see a little bit coming in, so I'm just going to rotate a bit, maybe bring it up a bit. Rotate again. Let's see. 5, 3, 6, 8, 8, 7. And you
wrist is going up. I'm extending.
I can't see that.
And that's important to watch what the wrist is doing, because as we might show that you, where the recording electrode is over the EDC, if you were to stimulate a median nerve or an ulnar nerve, it may pick up the flexor forearm muscle CMAP response from through volume conduction. So if she's stimulating and my hand's going down, then you know it's not a radial response.
And if somebody is helping you on the computer and you have both hands to tech, sometimes if it's really hard to bring in and the person has just a really big elbow, what I do is I press in, rotate up, and then I'll even take my hand and kind of push this way. It works.
Yeah.
Okay, so we've got 12-4 or 12-6. So now we're going to move up to the spiral groove.
Question, does the radial motor usually show so much temporal dispersion?
I won't use the term temporal dispersion for this. Temporal dispersion is usually refers to a change in the duration of the waveform between two sites. But what the question's referring to is it looks spread out, it's a wide waveform, and it has a notch there. And the answer is yes, it looks like that because even though the electrode is over, we think it's over one muscle, it really isn't. It's picking up through volume conduction activity of all of these forearm muscles. And so that gives a broader waveform. It's similar to the anterior tibialis in the leg, and similar to some of the other more proximal muscles. But you can get full because many times when there's true temporal dispersion, the waveform looks kind of wavy and ratchety instead of a nice dome appearance. This is a normal looking appearance from this recording site.
Do you prefer the EDC or the EIP?
Yeah, I thought someone would ask that, and I was going to mention, our standard recording site is the EDC, but there's no reason why you can't record from EIP, and occasionally we do, particularly if we think that the radial neuropathy may be more distal to the EDC, kind of in the forearm. If clinically the finger extensors are weak, we're still recording the finger extensors, but if we want a more distal, if we're thinking of a posterior interosseous neuropathy, it's easy to record over EIP. In fact, we can show you that here in a moment. All we do is you place the G1 electrode. In fact, why don't we just show for a second right here. So right over, if you follow EIP, if you extend the index finger, if you follow the tendon of the EIP, the muscle actually originates on the ulna. So you place this just medial to the or lateral, I guess, in anatomic position to the ulna, about 3 finger breaths proximal to the ulna styloid process. And you stimulate at the exact same site. And usually this is a smaller muscle, so usually it's a nice domed appearance. So we can, you can just stimulate here and just to show maybe on a different trace. Mm-hmm. Sometimes, you can record both sites. You can do a 2-channel recording, recording from both sites.
Same string.
That's fine. So there it is. And you'll notice it's, you know, it's a more normal looking appearance to some extent. Now there's a positivity. If you see, maybe point that out, there's an initial positive dip, which typically means that you're not over the recording electrode, the G1 electrode isn't over the end plate. And many times you move the electrode to make sure you get the maximum response. With this recording site, you can't often get rid of that. Because again, you're not just recording from EIP. There are extensor pollicis, there are a number of other extensor muscles, and the G1 electrode's not over the end plate of some of those muscles. So you, even if you move this around, it's very difficult to get rid of that initial positivity at this site. So maybe we'll go back to here. Is that where it was?
Yes.
So this is a nerve that we often will stimulate more proximally, especially if we're concerned about a conduction block. Maybe flip it back to the EDC trace two. I can move here.
Okay, so the spiral groove, I like to just kind of go at the lower border of the deltoid, like where it inserts. So we're going to start about here. I like to have it just vertical to the arm, and then I'll kind of move it up and down to try to locate the nerve first, and then I might go horizontally to get the best response. So we'll start here.
This is a hard site to stimulate the nerve, and it's not because it's there it is. The nerve curves around, and sometimes it's difficult to find it. You have to slide quite a bit. So that was easy.
Not hard for me.
Not hard for Jennifer. No. You'll notice one thing that if you look at the amplitudes between elbow and spiral groove, the spiral groove is higher than the amplitude. That should not happen. Physiologically, that shouldn't happen. So probably it's a bit of understimulation at the elbow. And normally in the patient, we would go back to the elbow, re-stimulate, increase the stimulus intensity, increase the duration if we had to make sure that we're truly maximum. We're not gonna do that right now. Not because I don't mind being shocked for sake of time.
All right, so now we're gonna be kind of deep in the armpit, and we're going to have to watch for the movement of the hand to go up. So we're just going to, you can't see. There we go. Okay.
Stay right, keep stimulating there for a moment. So this is a good finding here. If you look at that, and if you stopped right there, you'd say, oh, it drops from 13 to 8.7. That might be suspicious for a conduction block. Maybe there's some temporal dispersion. The waveform looks different. So there's a lesion between spiral groove and the upper arm. But watch my hand. I'm going down, I'm flexing. So that's not radial nerve stimulation. That's picking up a response, volume conducted response, probably from the median or ulnar muscles. So you have to be cautious not to misinterpret that waveform as a radial response. So the radial nerve here is usually more posterior. So there, that looks a little better. And my triceps, I'm extending. So that's probably the radial nerve there. Although my wrist is not extending, but my triceps is. So you may have to just go up a little higher. So there we go. And this also is tricky because you want the median ulnar and radial nerve and the axilla are very close together. So this can be really challenging to fine tune the amount of stimulus to slide to make sure you're confident that the response you're obtaining is a pure radial response. That amplitude is much higher. So it probably is composed of a combination of radial innervated muscles and some non-radial muscles. So in that situation, I don't know, what would you do?
Well, you try to reduce the stimulus.
And then maybe slide a little more posterior. Keep going posterior. So she's sliding posterior. And then what I do is slide posterior, now increase the stimulus because you're getting away from the median and ulnar nerve somewhat. So that looks more similar.
Yeah, then it kind of hopped up.
Yeah, but and then so then you'd be looking and we can just demonstrate. So this is where it's tough because you want to make sure you're truly maximum. So we would go increase, and probably what will happen is if you increase the stimulus more, the shape of the waveform is going to change a little bit as you bring in another nerve. So you can show that. So see how that looks different? Go back to the other one behind before that. So that extra bump on the right, the later bump is probably another muscle that's coming in. Mm-hmm. And then we can show, as a last demonstration, we can show Herb's point stimulation, which is also challenging.
So you want to have the cathode, I'd start the cathode facing to the left or going toward the arm. You're going to be halfway between the sternum and the acromion. And here's the clavicle. So, and you have to apply firm pressure.
And you're always watching the arm. It's hard for you to see that. Yeah, maybe move that so you can see the arm. So my elbow's flexing, so that's probably more of an upper trunk. We want kind of the middle trunk, a middle or a lower trunk.
While you're finding that, I'll ask a few questions.
Sure.
Go work backwards. Can temporal dispersion be expected here as it is so proximal?
It shouldn't. You should still have the same duration or similar. It might increase a little bit, but it should be a similar. It should, the duration shouldn't increase by more than about 10 or 15% between the sites.
And then for 15% of the population with absent duct, is it mostly bilateral or unilateral?
It can be both. It's often unilateral, and it's not always absent. It may be low, which complicates things even further, that it might be a low amplitude, that part of that is duct innervated and part is radial. I can't remember the numbers, but I think in the study, there were two studies recently that showed this. I think they were published in Muscle and Nerve, and I don't remember the percentage. It might have been 20 or 30%. It was bilateral, and most of the time it was unilateral. But I'm not sure about those numbers.
Okay, and then one comment was, it often happens that the proximal amplitude is higher than distal amplitude for radial motor. Would you agree with that, or do you think it's more of other nerves being stimulated?
Yeah, that's what we were showing, that it physiologically, you cannot have a higher amplitude proximally than distally. It doesn't happen. Just because there is normal temporal dispersion, a slight amount of temporal dispersion when you're stimulating and recording over a longer distance. So the duration increases a little bit and the amplitude goes down a little bit. So if you have a higher amplitude on any nerve, particularly the radial, but any nerve, if it's higher proximally than distally, you're either understimulating distally or you're overstimulating proximally and you're bringing in some other muscle. So with the radial, I'd say it's much more likely you're bringing in another muscle.
I'll leave the last couple questions for when you're done with this response.
All right, we'll give like five more shocks and then we'll finish.
All right.
So what? No pressure. One point about stimulating at Herb's point, and it's going to be hard to see this, is the way I think about how to place the cathode and anode is, if you think about the neck, and let's see if I can stick. So if you think about the neck, you have your roots and then you have the plexus coming down here, right? So if my fingers are the plexus, my ring finger is the lower trunk, my middle is the middle trunk, and my index finger is the upper trunk. So if I'm trying to stimulate the lower trunk, I want the cathode pointing down towards that finger. So I want the cathode pointing down towards the clavicle. If I'm interested in the upper trunk, I want the cathode pointing upwards. So for this, and you might have been doing this, I would have the cathode here. And then you still have to often rotate to get the trunk that you're interested in stimulating. Mm-hmm. So you can say the cathode, maybe show this. Just the cathode here is in green, and that's going to be pointing down towards the clavicle.
Yeah, I had the anode just rotated differently this.
Yeah.
So.
And this all often, anytime you stimulate, you have to rotate around. I am extending. My hand is extending here.
I don't want you. All right.
So, you know, again, we won't belabor it, but it looks somewhat similar. It's not perfect. So there may be something else being brought in. And again, remember, you can't isolate just the radial nerve, just the middle trunk. So if you depolarize the lower trunk, there's muscles that are around here that are ulnar innervated or lower trunk innervated. So that waveform may not look perfectly that's similar to the other waveforms. Okay, we're up for a few questions.
Yeah, thank you. I've got a few more questions here that I'll ask. One, would that be a lot easier to get a response with a unipolar stim head on that, on the Herb's point? You ever use that?
You want to answer that?
A monopolar?
Yeah.
Well, I'm only at 57 and I haven't increased my duration. So I'm probably not at a point where I would use the monopolar, but I have before. I have used it where when I feel like I'm not able to reach the nerves.
Yeah, the one problem with the monopolar at Herb's point is that the current isn't as localized. So if it's not as localized, you're at risk of that current spreading and depolarizing multiple areas of the plexus. So I think the time you would use the monopolar is if you've used the bipolar stimulator and you've gone up to 100 milliamps and 1 millisecond duration, and you're still, if it's a really thick neck or you just can't be sure you're super maximal, then that would be the time you would do that.
Yeah. And if the LAC or MAC is absent or low amplitude compared to the other side, how would you know whether this is technical or real disease?
Well, you hope it's not technical. If you know,
if Jennifer did the conductions, I trust her. She knows what she's doing. And I think, in all honesty, if you aren't sure, you usually come out and say, look, I couldn't get it. There were technical problems. I'm not convinced that this is a real response or a real absent response or that it's not there. Sometimes I'll go back in and check, but to be honest, most of the time, if I recheck, I don't get anything different. So it's tough. And I think that's where clinical judgment comes into play. And if you're not getting a response and you really think it should be there, you just have to be cautious in how you're interpreting that. And then we're also doing all the techniques that we show. We're sliding, where sometimes you work hard and then you have to take everything off and just replace the electrodes and just try again.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Couple more. One from a bit back was, why stimulate at the below elbow? Is it not easy to find below radial groove or both above muscle or for both above muscles? So I think they're referring to the previous stims.
For the radial? I think for the radial. Why do we do the elbow site? Well,
why stimulate at the below elbow?
Yeah, so we're often trying to localize the problem. Right, so if we stimulate at the spiral groove, most of the radial neuropathies most radial neuropathies will be at spiral groove, right? So one point is that we stimulate at the proximal spiral groove, right? Because if you stimulate too distal to like a compressive neuropathy, your amplitude, if it's conduction block, your amplitude is going to be fine. So you need to stimulate the proximal spiral groove. So let's say we did that and we got an amplitude of 7. We don't know if that's normal or not. We don't have good normal values for our lab. We often will compare side to side. So if that's 7, and even if it's low, we don't know where the lesion is. Is that axonal loss from a more proximal lesion, or is there a conduction block between spiral groove and the elbow? So it gives you two stimulation sites where you can compare. And if I was 7 at the spiral groove and at my elbow, my amplitude was 12 or 13, that's a substantial drop. And that would make me think that there's a lesion between the elbow and spiral groove. So it just gives you more sites and a more distal site that should be normal. It's rare to have a radial neuropathy in the forearm, but it helps to localize.
We've got some requests for some additional nerves that we'll leave for a future demonstration. And I guess we'll finish up with this question. Any precautions in doing NCS EMG during this COVID pandemic?
Oh boy, that's a good question. I think I'll tell you what we're doing. Obviously, everyone needs to use precautions and as much precautions as you can. I think all of us, it's great that we're doing what we need to do to help our patients, but we need to be careful. We need to be safe for ourselves at the same time. Our lab has been busy the last couple of weeks. We're doing a fair amount of patients. We are wearing masks. That's a Mayo Clinic policy. We're using eye shields. Some eyewear. There's a suggestion of using face shields if patients are not able to wear masks. All of our patients are masked as well. We had our infection precaution team come around and look at our practice, what we do, and they did not feel that any additional measures were warranted here. Meaning testing all of our patients pre-procedure. That is done in other areas, but it was not felt that was necessary to be done in EMG. That may be different from other institutions. I'm sure other places, if they are able to, they might be testing patients. So what we're doing is we're using masks for us, masks for the patients, eyewear, and we're obviously cleaning the rooms very carefully, cleaning the equipment after every use and standard practices like that.
Great. Thank you, Dr. Rubin, and thank you, Jennifer, and thanks for everyone that participated and joined in. Lots of good questions. And we have this recorded, so you'll be getting a recording of this video in your email if you registered. And we had a very large attendance, so I appreciate everyone for their time. And thank you again.
Great.
Thank you.
Everyone be safe.
All right, I'll end it. Thank you, guys.